Wait, you have a TV?
No, I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide, you don't need a TV.
Welcome. It is Wednesday. It is time for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor. I am Ken Reed, your TV Guidance Counselor, as always, now, and forever. I will always be your TV Guidance Counselor. How romantic of me. This is the show where we use old TV guides to discuss the popular culture we grew up watching, television, and, you know, we usually get off topic as well, but how that affected us as adults. And I talk to a lot of friends, acquaintances, people that I love and respect, whose work I always enjoy, and it's fun to hear about their experiences watching things and also making the things that we listen to or watch. And today is no exception. My guest today is Danny O'Connor. You probably know several Danny O'Connors if you, like me, are from Boston, but this is a very specific Danny O'Connor. This Danny O'Connor you may know better as Danny Boy from House of Pain, La Coca Nostra, and the urban exploration team Delta Bravo. So I really love talking to Danny, and if you want to see him, you're in Boston, or actually most of the U.S., House of Pain's doing a tour. He is playing, I believe, on the 17th here at the Roxy in Boston, which I think has a new name now. I called it the Roxy because I'm 180 years old, but you should check them out for sure. I will likely be at that show. It'll be a fun kind of St. Patrick's thing to do here in Boston, so definitely check that out. But I love talking to Danny. He's a really good dude and has a fascinating story and a really fascinating and unexpected connection to a lot of things that I think you will be surprised by in the best possible way. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy today's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, Danny O'Connor.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
So Danny O'Connor, how are you?
I'm good. Thanks for having me.
Thank you so much for doing this. We were just chatting a little bit before the episode about some of the stuff you do with locations and kind of being super
the
into
Delta Bravo urban exploration team.
It touched my heart because that's, you know, why we come out here to LA, and it's I waited so long to come out here because everyone on the East Coast is like, fuck that, it's awful. Right. And I'm like, I come out here, I'm like, no, it's great. And I feel so comfortable here.
Nice.
Everything's so familiar. And even just where we're staying, my wife and I this morning, we were down at the Hollywood Towers because they shot Leon's apartment in Midnight Madness there.
Oh, wow.
We're like,
you live and you learn. No matter how much you learn or you know, you think you know, you'll always find something out. And it's even funny that you come from Boston and you would tell me, and I've been here for eons. And I even went on ride along with LAPD as like a, you know, a 4-hour ride along to see what they do. And they started pointing out stuff for maybe about 2 minutes before I took over the conversation.
Yeah.
And I took them on a 4-hour tour. When I was done, they were like, wow, dude, we patrol this thing. We do it day in and day out. And we just got schooled. So
they were like, can you come every week?
Right. It was like a definite a feather in my cap when you could school, you know, someone who patrols the whole thing, you know, day in and year out.
So. It's mundane for them. So they're probably not, you know, thinking about
it the same way.
Well,
I took them deep. It was a deep cut. I started showing them stuff that they, you know, there's some obvious ones, like let's say Bronson Canyon where the Batcave hole is and stuff like that. Everybody kind of knows those. I won't say everybody. It was, I didn't go to that Bronson Cave until I was, you know, a couple of years back, only like 5 years ago.
Yeah.
But also because maybe I wasn't as interested as I was now that I get to do what I do. But yeah, there's so much to see. When you think you've seen it all, it's a rabbit hole. You just never, there's deeper levels. The onion just keeps getting peeled. So.
Oh yeah. I mean, you right down the street here, there's like the house from Nightmare on Elm Street, and it's basically across the street from the houses from Halloween.
Yeah.
And they're just on this suburban side street, and it's, For me growing up in Boston, which seems a million miles away from all this stuff, you see it and it's right there and you can't believe it.
Right.
It's like you were saying earlier, it's like you stepped into the movie that you watched.
Yeah, it's like being in a set that hasn't been stricken. I mean, I'm a New Yorker, but I came here when I was 6 years old, and then by the time like I was aware of like where we were, this is when all these films were being made. So like Fast Times at Ridgemont High, Valley Girl, movies such like that. Those were shocking to me because I was living in the Valley and I was like, wait a minute, these movies are all being shot and taking place in the Valley. People talk that way. It was like Val speak and the people dressed that way, like surfers or new wave type of things. And I was shocked. And in my neighborhood, Todd Bridges lived from
Different Strokes.
We used to roller skate on the weekends, and Adam Rich from Eight Is Enough was always in there. So I would call back east to my cousins, and I think half the time they thought I had like a problem with lying.
Yeah.
You couldn't.
Sure.
Yeah, coming from the East Coast, especially where we were at, Staten Island and Brooklyn, you didn't run into like television personalities, or to be, they were child stars. I mean, they were stars. People used to mob them when they weren't, when they left, you know, when they were in the neighborhood at the park playing football, it was still people who crowd around to look. But outside of that, I mean, yeah, they were stars.
Oh yeah. I mean, there was fewer networks. So
everybody was
shows.
Watching. Yeah. There was like seven channels to choose from. Basically it got piped into your hard drive, being, you know, through your eyes, into your brain, into your, that, you know, that hard drive in your head, and that was it. So you got a steady diet of those people, no matter who it was on TV back then, and they leave a lasting impression, you know?
Yeah, I mean, it's one of the things we always talk about on this show is that, you know, people in our generation and older, these shows stick in their head forever and mean so much to them because there was so much less. You only watched them once a week, and there was... you weren't in the overload. So you would watch shows you didn't even like just because you had to watch something.
Well, it's funny you say that because I have a love hate with a few shows like that. One in particular, MASH, you know, MASH and the Doors, the group. Some days I love listening to Doors records, or when they come on the radio, I'm like, wow, I love the Doors. And there's other times like, I hate the Doors.
Yeah, this is not
and
for
MASH
me.
Comes on sometimes on TV and I go, oh, I love MASH. I love the theme song. What a great show. And then there's other times I can't stand that even the sound of the song drives me bonkers. And I don't know what that is, but it was just weird. I think it has a lot to do with like emotions that are attached as a child.
Yeah.
And that would come on right before the lights would come on. You had to come home.
Yeah.
And if depending on what mood my stepfather was in or my mother was in, it could be great. It could be bad. And so I don't know if there's like a weird little like psycho,
some synapse got
some weird going
there.
On. Yeah. So it's like, you know, of course I love MASH, but there's times where I go, why did I ever like this thing?
Yeah.
And so.
Oh yeah. It's it's weird where, you know, just it, unlike music, which, you know, you come from the music world,
right,
which is a part of everybody's life, but in a more personal way because they can kind of soundtrack whatever they're doing with music,
yeah, of course,
because it's more passive. TV is you're engaged, you're watching it with your family or maybe with a sibling, and no matter where we are now and how different you are from somebody, if you go back far enough, we all watch the same stuff.
Always.
So it's the shared experience.
Yeah, you're right. It's like a shared library that we both basically had X amount of books, and we've all read them, so we're all fluent at certain levels on all of these things.
Yeah.
So I don't know anybody from my generation that hasn't seen Happy Days.
Right.
I don't know anybody who hasn't seen Alice. I don't know anybody who hasn't seen Eight Is Enough. And all those shows, we all watch those, The White Shadow.
Yeah, the Brady Bunch, you know,
Brady Bunch for sure.
I could talk to someone who I am complete different, you know, they're like the most vicious
polar opposite. Yeah,
yeah, and they'll bring out the Brady Bunch and be like, oh yeah, oh my nose, and it's like a really weird universal thing that we all have.
Yeah, of course.
So when you kind of came to this revelation as a kid that they were making all this stuff around you that was piped out to the whole rest of the country, did that sink in on that level then, or was it later when you were an adult?
No, I mean, obviously, I mean, I was aware of Hollywood. I remember the first time I came into Hollywood, I came in the back of a pickup truck with a friend's dad, and everybody had pickup trucks back then, you know, full size, and you could have kids in the back with no seatbelts, and
yeah.
I think there was even a dog back there with us, but maybe it wasn't. And I remember coming down Hollywood Boulevard and being able to glimpse the Hollywood sign, and I think probably prior to that, I'd only seen it in movies or in Happy Days when, you know, they came to LA or whatever that thing was. But so it was a big deal, but I still didn't grasp the concept that all this stuff was being made here. It wasn't until, like I said, like Fast Times at Ridgemont High. I mean, we lived a couple miles away from the Galleria, the Sherman Oaks Galleria.
Yeah.
That movie also, Valley Girl, the same thing. I mean, I was a Valley guy, if you will, and you know, we spoke like that, like, oh my God. And
so people weren't like, this is bullshit, it's not like this.
No,
like,
it was
this
spot
is exactly
on. Yeah, it was spot on. And so it kind of just was like a, in the 80s, there was a certain time where like everybody listened to the same records. Like, it was like the status quo was listening to rock records, you know, your quintessential Van Halen, Black Sabbath, Led Zeppelin, whatever. And at least in Southern California, I noticed the change in the guard starting to happen around 1980 when K-Rock came out.
Yeah.
And K-Rock started playing new wave. So I was too young for punk. That seemed really abrasive to me.
Yeah.
And I wasn't really down with like the metal thing. And I grew up in a roller rink and I grew up ice skating. And so we listened to like what the DJ would play, especially for roller skating. It was like disco based, really.
Yeah. Well, freestyle
and so
stuff.
When I started hearing new wave, it was like a breath of fresh air because it was halfway between punk rock and halfway between disco, and depending on who it was. So when I listen to Duran Duran, I'm hearing, bass lines from Chic, you know, that he like lifted, but it's got that appeal, yet it's brand new and it's from England and chicks dig it, and I'm going to the mall and I'm buying Duran Duran.
Yeah.
So even though New Wave, obviously, you know, again, it was a British thing and maybe even a New York thing at some point, it was celebrated at the epicenter, which was like the Sherman Oaks Galleria, and New Wave, Preppy, and Valspeak went hand in hand, and so I felt it was like...
It was sort of the eye of a storm that was going on throughout this area.
Which is weird, because now you try to tell people about the Valley and they don't even, you can't see it. It's hard for me to, I don't even bother to tell anybody, like, you know, old war stories, how good it was, because they don't know if they can understand. But there was a time in the Valley, man, where it was like, I think the thing was to make money in Hollywood and then move to the Valley and have a nice suburban, you know. And all the kids I knew at the time, you know, parents had money to burn and they all got cars at 16, luxury cars, and spent money at the mall. And I wasn't one of those kids, but I definitely was like, wow, hopefully someday, you know,
I can get a piece of the American dream. So what brought you from Brooklyn out to here?
Well, my mother moved out here for the computer industry. She worked at the Chase Manhattan Bank as a key punch operator. This is going back to index cards and running those through a computer. Right. That's where we get its information. And the Valley, the San Fernando Valley in California, is a hotbed for all the Cold War stuff. So, like Litton, Teledyne, Rocketdyne. So it was all those, all that stuff was in the San Fernando Valley. So we came out here for, you know, business opportunities for my mother.
That's such an extreme.
It was great. You know, it was culture shock at first. Again, it was pre-MTV. It was pre, internet, obviously. And so it was a culture shock for a while. And, I really, my first like recollection of like really latching on to California life, you know, even though I had been here for years, and I used to go back every summer to New Jersey, they'd send me back. So I still felt like connection to East Coast stuff. But when I really felt connected for the first time was again, and I hate to, you know, we'll probably talk about it 20 more times, but and everybody knows me, knows why, but like that Fast Times thing locked it in for me, because I was like, okay, that's dope. This is what's going on in my thing, and that's what we're going to look like. That's what we're going to sound like. You can relate to those characters, and
Well, I think people now that are probably younger than us don't understand the impact that Fast Times had on how it was a realistic portrayal of kids that age.
Cameron Crowe.
Yeah, he got the language because he undercovered in a high school.
He did.
Like he was.
I was giving you, people at home, they can't see. I was giving you that eye, like I was holding on for you, making sure you knew what it was. Yeah, and you know, so. That could, in my opinion, that could never happen again.
No.
Because there was a time in the 70s where, it was that time, but the 70s were a different, how do I say it? You could never get a 22-year-old man to convince a principal to let you attend undercover high school for 1 year around women.
If you could, we have 18 reality shows about it.
You'd lose your job, you lose your career, you lose your...
Yeah.
But I don't think people thought like that back then, and I know it took a little wrangling on his part. I think if I remember the story correct, I don't remember the band, but I think the principal was like, wait, what? And you want to do what?
Yeah.
And you do what? You're a writer for Rolling Stone?
He toured with Led Zeppelin, I think.
The Almost Famous movie was really like a biopic about him. But I think it was like he covered some band that the principal was like, wait a minute, you wrote a story about...
Oh, you like that band?
Yeah, was it the Eagles or whoever it was? He was like, wow, okay, well...
I love Heart.
I don't see why not, what it can hurt. And I think that after he let him do it, after he signed off on it, he kind of completely forgot about him until the end of the year.
When
he's like, wait a minute, like... Couldn't believe he was there. But yeah, he captured that generation. And I think, you know, even though he went back to school in San Diego, California, which is, you know, a couple hours away from here, and in essence, worlds apart from, you know, Southern California to, they were both Southern California, but, you know.
Extreme Southern California.
Yeah, but it just something rang true about it. And when they filmed it in the Valley with, you know, it locked in, and I think everybody could relate. And I remember when it was like it was yesterday, I remember seeing E.T., on the East Coast in New Jersey or New York, and the trailer for Fast Times at Ridgemont High had debuted there, and I was like, wait a minute, that's my... It was the same time, 82.
Yeah.
I was like, wait a minute, I know this, I know that mall.
I know that park.
I couldn't believe it. I was like, I know these spots. And so...
And of course, Chopping Mall was shot in that mall.
Yeah, you're good, it was. It was actually, and you know what, you can get... So I ended up just a fast, you know, just a, I'll scoot up a bit, but so I made a lot of money early on with House of Pain, yep. You know, and the first thing I wanted to do was buy myself a house. And the first place on earth that I could ever imagine buying a house was right by the Sherman Oaks Galleria. So I bought a beautiful house, if you're familiar with California, right on Valley Vista and Sepulveda. And you could see the Galleria basically from my house, okay? And right as the escrow closed on that house, the Northridge earthquake kicked off.
Yeah.
There was zero damage to the house, but there was a lot of damage to that mall. You couldn't see it, but it was structurally. And by the time, the mall was built in the 80s, and by the time I got that house in like 94, so it was like second year of House of Pain, 94 earthquake, so it was 94 yep. for sure. That mall, things have changed.
Yeah.
You know, kids weren't going to the malls like they used to. Yeah. People weren't shopping at the malls. So the mall became like a glorified swap meet. It was really pathetic after the earthquake.
All the chains start going away and you see these weird
half open stores, people with earthquake survival kits and Chinese merchants selling like
stores
weird stuff from China.
Forever.
It was horrible. Yeah. Yeah. Hey, you see it in just about every mall now. But at the time, for Sherman Oaks, California, a pretty wealthy, you know, Southern California.
Well, you see the mall in the movie. You see it when it's at its height.
So shopping mall, you see a lot more of it. It was also in The Last Commando, I think, or one of those.
Commando, he has the fight in the elevator.
Yep.
And now, it's in that movie Nightmares. Emilio Estevez fights the Duke of Battle in the arcade in there, I think.
It could be. There's also, so Valley Girl, it's actually in a different mall. They use pieces of cutaways to it. And same with Fast Times. When you see him originally going into the mall, he's in Santa Monica.
Yeah, it's the
Mike
third.
DeMone's going to the 3rd Street Mall. Yeah. Now that's gone. That's Nike Town.
Yeah.
You can't even tell it was there because they actually extended the street through there.
So, it's so weird.
I'm fascinated by all that stuff. I know if you're listening in and you're not, you know, I apologize in advance.
No, I think people listening to this would be, because I am as well. I mean, this is...
So I own the yearbook, the Fast Times at Ridgemont High yearbook, which is the 1979 Claremont High School. That's the one that he attended.
That's, right.
Paid $500 for that. You know what? That you're the second person to ask, and it sounds retarded. I should have been like, yeah, I had a look.
That's the first thing I looked for.
I'm good friends now because I kind of do what you do. I do a little radio show and this and that. And I met Robert Romanus, who played Mike DeMone, who was my hero in that movie. I mean, I related to his character because I felt like I got that East Coast thing. I'm living in California. I'm that you want to buy a watch kind of guy.
Right.
Hip slick and sick and, you know, doing my thing. So I always loved him, the character of Mike DeMone. So when I had the opportunity to interview him and then we hit it off, I just bothered him until he became my friend.
Yeah, like, he owns a coffee shop or something for a while.
Yeah, he just actually got rid of it. He sold it and he's working on, you know, he's going to do some teaching and good stuff like that. But when I, you know, I just picked his brain every time we get coffee, every time we get something to eat. Mike. Yeah. Robert, tell me this, tell me that. 100 times on accident. I mean, you know, and that's the thing. There's Robert Romanus and there's Mike DeMone.
Yeah.
Sometimes I forget, you know, because you hear his voice. But my point is that I brought him in maybe 2 weeks ago to interview him again because I got a new radio gig. And my co-host said, it was the first time I ever even thought to look for Cameron Crowe in the yearbook. So I got to go look for it. I forgot to after he asked. I won't forget now. I can tell you who is in there. So the football character, that's a real character.
Yeah.
It's one guy, and I forget his name. I'm not good with this kind of these things. Phoebe Cates' character is a real Linda Barrett.
Yep.
That's a real character.
And I think Rat was two characters in the book.
No, Rat is one. Is Andy one? Ratbone.
Okay.
And he's the writer of those like Mac OS for Dummies or...
Oh, really?
Oh, he's a millionaire off of those books for dummies.
Wow.
He's a famous writer. I'll tell you who the composites are. Jeff Spicoli, it's two people.
Yep.
There's a guy named like Jeff Natolo. And then there's another guy that they say, Mr. Hand is real, and he's in the yearbook.
So I didn't know the names were just like exactly...
Some. And then I still can't really get a beat on who DeMone was. I've read the books. Obviously, the books are different.
Which were hard to find forever, too. Yeah,
yeah, they're on eBay, but they, you know, you got to pay $100 or more for them.
Yeah.
So the yearbook's fascinating because you got most of the characters in there, and then there's a few composites. I would love to talk to Cameron about... You know, who really is this and who really, you know, whatever. But I mean, he nailed it. But I'm a fanatic about it. So I spent another, and I'm not trying to drop dollar amounts because it's not that big in the grand scheme, but
it shows how much you're into it.
Yeah, and I searched high and low for years until I finally found the Deborah Harry standee.
Yeah,
so I have the not the one from the movie. I got one, and which is ironic because that's the one, that's the best scene in the movie for me. Yeah. Is the 5-point plan, hey, because as a kid at the time I needed some help with the ladies, and so the 5-point plan to me is so brilliant.
Yeah,
and it was so rock solid until that part where he flubs the Led Zeppelin point. Yep. But that's what even makes it more brilliant. You know what I mean? Because yeah. No matter how great he is, there's always that, and there's so many different ways to look at that scene. But talking to Deborah Harry, that standee, that's from a record, I think, from like 78. Because yeah. Plastic Letters is way before 80. Yeah. No, it was like in the 70s.
Yeah.
So I found the standee, the full-size one. They make a 12-inch one for the counter and the full-size one. And I could not believe it. So I got it. And I've also reenacted the scene.
Of course.
Of course I did. And God bless Robert Romanus, man. He's allowed me to... He's just, all right, Danny, let's do it.
Yeah.
You know, like, hey, get it out of the way. Danny, I'm really kind of busy. Yeah. And he just allows me to just like... you know, just fan out to the 10th yeah. power, and God love him. And as a person, he's a prince among men. I mean, he's one of the, I cherish our friendship more than he knows. And you know,
well, cause it's
unfortunate to know these type of cats, you know what
yeah,
I mean?
And, you can come out here and these people are in these things that you were such an important part of your life.
Yeah, man.
And for them to, cause sometimes people can be dismissive about that stuff. Like, that's a job I did. I don't know why you're so yeah. obsessed with it. But I thought that would be the case, like when I started doing this show and I've got to talk to all these people. But I found it's the exact opposite. For the most part, they're like, "Wow, that's so great that meant so much to you.
Yeah,
like, it means
yeah,
something
yeah,
to me
yeah.
that it means something to you." And that's refreshing.
And that's how Robert is. And people who are not, they're just dicks. You know, later yeah. for them. I mean,
there are some.
If you're allowed to, there's a lot of. Yeah. I mean, not only in that, in music, I've seen it. Believe me, you know, ad nauseum. But the point is that you know, it's. If you're fortunate enough, talented enough, all the above, you know what? Be humble and be yeah. and give of yourself. It doesn't, you know, there are worse things to do, to be, you know what I mean? You should yeah. be so lucky. And that's not pointed at anybody. I'm just saying, I get it. You know yeah. what I mean? I got people bother me still about little things. I rapped, great.
And questions you've heard a million times.
Yeah, and yeah. I just got to put on a smile and you do what you do. And it's not because, you know, I get it. Sometimes you can't be bothered and you're busy, but yeah. you know, I always try to take time out, and people have been that way with me for the most part, but there are a few dicks.
Yeah, there are a few.
Can I curse? It's too late.
Yeah. Oh yes, please do. Okay. In fact, all cursing. Did you ever watch the Fast Times TV series?
No.
I loved it.
Okay. So you're the first person on record. I'm going to put that in my hard drive as well. And no, I've never met anybody who liked it. So you're my first. Number two is when that came out, so I'm 47, I just turned 47. So by the time that came out, it's like anything, you know, like the Beastie Boys' License to Ill come out. And it was like, we played it until the tape popped, and we yeah. played it for 1 year straight. Everybody played that tape. You'd jump in one car to another car to another car to the party, and you'd hear Beastie Boys at some point all throughout that night.
Yeah.
And then there was a year after that where nobody wanted to touch it with a, you know, yeah. And then it took about 5 years, and then it became cool again. Well, Fast Times for me was like that. And after that 5-year gap, that's when that TV show yeah. happened. And then we got far enough away from it to look back at it and go, wow, remember Fast Times, man?
Yeah.
I was like, yeah, that's cool again. And it always has that cool down period.
Yeah.
So no, I never seen the TV show. And I also get really weirded out about those things, even though, and I'm just going to say this, is if you like it, I'll give it a second look. I've tried, and I feel the same way about The Outsiders, because I love them in their entirety. I don't like the redo of The Outsiders, right. where they added the scenes that were cut out and they added a new score. The Carmine Coppola one was genius.
Yeah.
And like, so I don't like you're messing with my yeah. Yeah, the Warriors, they chopped it up as well.
Yeah,
they
put those comic book stuff in. Yeah. Yeah.
And that's another one of my favorites. And yeah. I've interviewed Apache Ramos, and we've done projects with him, who was the orphan. You know, shout out to him. And I got baseball bats. I happen to know a friend who now Don's my friend, but his brother and him are both stuntmen, and his brother Jerry Hewitt is the baseball fury. So I got baseball signed by him, bat signed by him. But when you see those movies as a kid, or however old you are, and they make an impact on you, it's sacrilege to go back 20 years and adjust it, you know, like, don't do it. Like, but people want to repackage, they could sell more DVDs or whatever, so I get it, but
it's weird that people seem to be more okay with it for movies and TV shows than, like, if you had your favorite album and someone goes, I went back and re-recorded all the guitar parts differently, people would be like, what the you can't do that.
Someone did that too. I'm trying to think who that was. Somebody really, I think
I'm sure they did
it at one point.
I know Glenn Danzig did that on all the Misfit stuff. He went back and played bass all over everything.
Oh, there's your dick anyway.
Well,
you want to air one out? No offense, but
you know, here's why I like the Fast Time show, and I won't go so far to like it better than the movie, although sometimes I do. It had the pedigree. Cameron Crowe's writing on it. Amy Heckerling's directing it.
So Cameron did write the show?
He did. He was a consulting producer, and he wrote some stuff on it. Okay. They had Moon Zappo was working on it. It's weird. It's like a bizarre universe because obviously they've recast everybody, except for the teachers who are the same. Mr. Vargas is the same.
Yeah,
Mr. Hand is in it. But it manages to capture some of the less dramatic stuff because it's not a movie, so they don't have to have this big stuff like abortions in it,
right.
And it's a little more day to day, so it's a little bit more relatable, and it's almost like a proto My So-Called Life or Freaks and Geeks. There's no single camera, there's no laugh track.
And you know what I like about, you know, at least they used the real people. The Outsiders as well. It was a TV show. Half my friends were in the TV show. So Robert Ressler and David Arquette.
Yeah.
And I know Jason, what's his name? Rodney, what's his name?
Oh,
rest in peace, the kid.
I can't think of
the Philadelphia kid. But yeah. Jason Rodney or something like that. Yeah, whatever. Yeah. I knew all those kids at the time in Hollywood. They were it.
Right after the Brad Pack, they were like the
they
next.
They were it. Yeah. No. So you know, that was when I was coming of age in Hollywood. So I was going to all the same clubs. We're all hanging out. We're all into hip hop. So I still talk to Robert Ressler, you know, on the regular. I actually had him on my show. And sometimes I forget, you know, I look at him like the dagger leader more than I look at him as, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I go, wait a minute, you were in The Outsiders, the thing. And it was S.C. Hinton and it was Coppola. So, and the story, it starts right off after Dally got murdered and it goes into, I've watched the thing. It's just really tough because I don't know. I just feel like people are messing with my emotions. Like there's more to the story. I don't want to know more to the story. I just like
what
I
have.
Yeah, I was good. Like it's in this beautiful little capsule. I don't want to break it out of the glass and add to it. So.
If there was more to the story, you came up with what more of the story was, and that may be like a different it didn't go this way, like
total different narrative.
I loved the show My So-Called Life, which was you were definitely not in the age group for that show, would have been like, I'm not watching this.
No.
But it ended after one season, and everyone was like, this was the greatest show ever, and the creator of the series put out a series of books based on the Bibles for the additional seasons that never happened. Wow. And I read them and I hated them because I'm like, they didn't get together. This is not. And I was kind of glad that it got canceled.
Because
I'm like, I didn't want this to happen.
I'm with you on that.
So sometimes if things are end early, it's better. Right. But I would recommend, I can get you the Fast Time series. I'd be curious to see.
You know what? They're online. I think I'm trying to think of the website from London that always has the cool whatever.
Yeah.
Is it? What's it called? They reposted about it like just about 2 weeks ago. Because I actually run, I don't know if people, you know, I do a little page on Facebook called the Mike DeMone Appreciation Society.
Excellent.
So I always post Mike DeMone quotes and posts and stuff. Yeah. You know, it's for shits and giggles.
Life philosophies with Mike DeMone.
Of course. Yeah, because, I mean, it's where I got most of my stuff. And, you know, every once in a while when a good story comes along, even if it's just Fast Times, it has to be obviously Fast Times related, but if it's not Mike DeMone specific yet, it's something cool like that. I post
in the spirit of DeMone.
That's right. Or in the spirit, just in Fast Times, if it's new info or something unreleased, there is actually, I don't remember what interview I saw, but somebody got the footage. So there's missing footage that shows up on like TBS.
Yeah.
If they show Fast Times on television, there's extra scenes that got cut that they throw back in. But the one they never show, and I've only seen it once, maybe I've seen it twice, but that day, but I've only seen it in one sitting and I don't remember what link it was, and it's obviously gone from the internet because I've searched, but there is a scene where Mike DeMone is in Licorice Pizza and Spicoli comes in and he's looking for a record and Mike turns him on to some bands. And I've seen it once. I think it was like maybe even somebody did an interview where they got a hold of it, and I would love to get it because I thank God for Facebook because it allows you to like cross-pollinate and talk to other people. And before long after DeMone, then I met a few other people in the movie, and you know, you get little bits and pieces, people who worked on it, people who were smaller parts in it, and you start building up a like a dossier of like all these extra cool, you know, behind the scenes facts. But it's the one little thing that I can't, it sucks to know that you've seen it and it was there and I could have just downloaded it and I didn't. And now I don't know who
has it. Well, you think it's going to be there forever.
Exactly.
And, you know, when we grew up, if you saw things in TV, we were like, no, there was extra scenes on TV. You couldn't prove it. Like, people would be like, I think you're crazy. Goonies was another one like that. There's deleted scenes with like an octopus attacking. Wow. And there were kids that swore they saw that scene and they're like, I've never seen that scene. It's like, it's in there. And you had no way to prove it, which was, again, to the East Coast thing where they're like, you're a liar. You did not see Todd Bridges. So you're doing a lot of this this urban exploring of these locations from movies. And I the first trip I ever did for that was in 2005. I went to Monroeville to go to the Monroeville Mall, which they shot Dawn of the Dead in. Another mall.
Where's that?
It's right outside Pittsburgh. Romero shot the original Dawn of the Dead there.
Yeah, it's classic.
And it was the closest thing I've ever had to like a religious experience. Like I'm
glad you said that, because sometimes people don't get it, and it's okay they don't get it. Again, we just do this. I have a crew of like 20 people solid, and maybe 50 people peripheral, but the 20 of us, man, I mean, it is everything, and it's addictive, because it is a religious experience. Like from Fast Times at Ridgemont High, let's say, I hit all the locations that were available on the internet, which were the obvious ones. Some of them are not there anymore. Some are shells of them. Some have still signage, but the actual is gone. And the only two rules that we have, and they're flexible rules, but they're good guidelines when you do urban exploration, especially our brand of it, which is like pop culture stuff, is no pools and no schools.
Yeah.
So I went to do the Nirvana pool, and I thought, it's December in California. Nobody's going to be at the pool. It's in Pasadena. And we get there, and there's thousands of kids.
Yeah.
And mid-photos, two guys in all black taking photos by the pool, and I go, wait a minute.
Yeah.
And the other guy was LAPD. And I was like, wait a minute, dude. This is probably not cool. Somebody's going to call you on us. Like,
it's not the kids. It's the pool I'm interested in.
You know, it's hard to explain that one. Parents started looking and pointing, and we were like, hey, let's get out of here.
Yeah.
And school's the same thing. So I had been at the outside of the Fast Time school, which is Van Nuys High School, which has been used in a lot of stuff. But I never could get in. And the holy grail for me was the Fast Times pool.
Yeah.
The Phoebe Cates pool. And so we had on our show, when we were doing the radio show, the first incarnation of it, I had the janitor from The Breakfast Club.
Yep.
And
he was in a ton of Hughes stuff.
He was great. And his line was, I am the eyes and the ears of the institution, my friend. I know you're this, I know you're that.
Yep.
And I thought, who is the eyes and the ears of the institution over here? It's the janitor. And my good friend, Jimmy Cash, in Worcester. How do you say it?
Worcester.
That's it, Worcester. Yep. He's a janitor.
Yep.
And I says, Jimmy. He says, yeah. I says,
contact the janitor network.
He goes, dude, it ain't like these cops, you know. We don't have a fraternal organization janitor, of like, we don't have any bat
the
channels.
The order
like
of the
that.
Mop.
Yeah. So, hey, we should start that. That'd be dope. He should start that. So he said, but I don't know. I'll reach out and give a call. And 20 minutes later, he says, I talked to the guy. He says, you can come on Saturday. He'll give you a tour of Mr. Hand's room. He'll give you a tour of you can go to the whole school, carte blanche. I said, you're kidding me. He says, no, I'm not kidding. You go Saturday, and this is who you talk to. So I showed up, opened up Mr. Hand's room, which is a computer room now, so it's a secured room. There's computers and, you know, expensive stuff in there. But he opened it up, and the blackboard is under, it's still there. It's just under the dry erase. They use those now. If you hadn't been to school in a while, they don't use
things
chalk anymore.
Changed.
Yeah. The doors have been updated, but they're still, I mean, everything is where it should be. And it was just like mind blowing to be in Mr. Hand's classroom 30 years later. And so after I posted the photos, my friend says, dude, do you see that? And I go, see what? He goes, look at you there. Before and after, you notice what thing is the same? And I go, oh my God, the trash can, the little, it's the same one, isn't it? And he goes, dude, if that ain't, I don't know what is.
Yeah.
And I looked and I go, oh my God, because I could have, I could have stole it.
Yeah.
I could have bribed the guy to give the trash can. I'm sure it was an old school metal that high, you know, if you're a foot and a half high, and I'm guaranteeing you it's been there for all
I'm
that
sure.
time.
Yeah.
Now, most people are, I'm sure, like, what would you want with that? I would want that.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, need to have that in my collection just because it was on set in the scene. So, you know, if you go to Van Nuys High and you're listening to that, that's mine. Don't touch it. Don't look at it.
I will find you.
I will find you. But, so I got to do those scenes. And then I just want to say this. The pool scene, The lady, I think, doesn't want nobody coming to her house. Yep. She's taking her address off the Google thing. So when you put her address in, it throws you a block down. So I did what any respectful Irishman would do. I had a friend who had a drone, and we flew it right over her house. We violated her spot, and we put it right in her backyard, 3 feet off the pool. If you're interested in seeing that, you don't care if you think it's a dick move or whatever.
You got to see it.
I did what I had to do to get what I needed to get.
It was the last
and
one.
It was the last one, and some other goon who tries to do what we do tried to beat us to it when there was no beating us to it. And so we did it, and you can look it up. Just Google Delta Bravo, Fast Times, pool, drone, those keywords, and it comes up, and it's pretty fantastic. And if you're mad at that, you got.
I'm picturing this woman looking at her house, which is just this nice Southern California house, like the people look at the Amityville Horror House.
Yeah, well,
we go to take the windows out so people stop coming by.
You know, here's the thing. When I did it, I knew it was a dodgy thing to do, and I knew that it was suspect in the sense that, like, yeah, it could piss people off. But I also figured, you know what? Nobody gets a house like this and doesn't know the history. And if you don't know the history, that you'll know now. And if you know the history, then just like where we're at right now, you're not that far from the Hollywood sign. We're pretty much beneath it. And I know this, the homeowners up here by the Hollywood sign, they're pissing and moaning the whole time through. They're $5 million, $20 million. You buy a house under the sign and you expect the regular people not to come up and want to see it, then you know, screw you, because you got what you know.
Yeah, it's like owning a murder house.
Yeah, it's like, yo, and it's happened. And so we visit these spots. We're the most respectful people on the planet like that. And rather than being knocked on your door and being told no and to screw, we elected just to fly a drone over. Truthfully, with Google Earth, I can get close to the same, not as high res, but I can get really good images. And I just figured, you know what, might as well just go for it and go for broke. So far, nobody that I know has been hurt by doing it. Yeah. Nobody's been affected. And I figured, worst case scenario, if it went viral, I mean, it's got over 100,000 looks on it. But if it went viral, like, immediately, then let's get on CNN and let's talk about drone laws and why can't I? I didn't break any laws.
Yeah.
I did what was in my right to do it. Was it, you know, offbeat or a dick move? Perhaps. But I'm not above doing that for the cause. And so then tell me it's not. And then I make amends, and then we'll break bread, you know?
And
but,
it's from a good place. Like you're
now, if I own the house and I knew the history and a drone came over, it might be met with my shotgun or it might be hit with a broom. I told my friend, if you lose your drone, I'll pay for your drone.
Yeah.
If it goes in the drink, we'll split it.
Yeah.
If the lady or the man comes out and they take it out midair, I got you.
Yeah.
And so, you know what? It is what it is. But I'm happy I did it. I don't regret it one bit. And, you know, it's part of that, like, you know, hey, man, that's how passionate I am in the movie. I needed to see it all. And that was one tool I had in my toolbox. I was going to employ it. So.
Well, because we were talking earlier that all this stuff we watched as kids, this was our escape.
Yeah.
And it was the thing that, still is. You know, in like TV Guide, one of the reasons that I have sort of this obsession with it was it came every week. I lived in a very chaotic situation in my house, and this was consistent, and I could rely on it.
Yeah.
And I could sit down and write, look, I'm watching this show every Thursday. No matter what awful thing happens this week, this thing's going to be on Thursday regardless. And so it was what I look forward to.
Yeah, listen, hey, I did the same with the Sears catalog. When I was in third grade to maybe fifth or sixth, I used to, that thing is literally the size of a phone book.
Oh, yeah.
And I used to take it to school with me, man. And every time I'd get some free time, I would open it up and dream.
Yeah.
I'd go in the music section. I'd go, I want these drums, a silver tone guitar. Go a couple things over to bedding. I want the Star Wars sheets. So it's all dreams. And my parents, it might be parents, but my mother, she couldn't afford that, most of it. And wasn't going to, even if she could, it wasn't in the cards.
Yeah.
But it was my out. It was my dream.
Yeah.
You know, to just, that was my first, like, my first drug of choice is out.
Yeah.
It's like, I don't like what I'm thinking and feeling and where I'm living and in the environment I'm in. How do I get out of here? And
right.
So TV was a good escape. Movies were a great escape. And believe it or not, the Sears catalog.
Yeah.
If you had one from the 70s, I'd buy it off you. I know they go for like a couple hundred bucks.
I have
now.
Several. I can hook you up.
That's a good
but that's why these locations mean so much to guys like us, because it's not just something that people did a job at.
No.
It's a part of our childhood. And it's the best thing I can equate it with is people who are huge sports fans when they go to like a special baseball stadium.
Yeah, no,
like,
I do those as well. You know, I went to, so for instance, I've been at Mickey Mantle's childhood home. I'm a diehard Yankees fan. You know, I know you're from the dark side of the fort. But listen, I tell everybody, you know, I bought a brick from Fenway. Fenway is the best park in the system. It is. If someone came from another planet and said, show me what baseball is, we would start at Fenway.
Yeah. It's one of the oldest.
And I've taken the tour. Yeah, it is the oldest one.
And is a candlestick the other one?
Candlestick's gone.
Oh, is
they
it?
Tore it down.
See my sports.
I got a tour of the Wrigley, which is the second oldest.
Yep.
And the third oldest now is Dodger Stadium.
Oh, okay.
It's going on 50. Just turned 50 like a year or two ago.
That's featured in Better Off Dead.
That it is with the Camaro and the thing. Yeah. I interviewed her. Last American Virgin, and that's what we really
such
that
a
was
bum
the
out movie.
Yeah. Had, oh, I was my like, how did you God. End it like that? You yeah. know why they ended it like that? Because it was a three-part, and they never made the other
yeah,
two movies. Because
the Lemon Popsicle is really
man.
Movies,
so you know
yeah.
your stuff. So
Menachem.
That's it. Yeah. So you know your thing. But so we do these sports things. So we drove. I drove from Beverly Hills in my cop car. I drove a cop car, guys.
He does everybody pulled up in his cop car.
Crown Victoria, and it does makes great for what I do. You know, yeah. people stay out of my way. They don't mess with it when it's parked. They don't want to break the windows for anything. They stay away from it. I picked up my friend in Tulsa because now I have friends in Tulsa because yep. the Outsiders Rumblefish connection. And we drove to Detroit, at which point we met my friend, two friends from New York, one who's an NYPD lieutenant and another one who's like a skateboard shop owner slash just, you know, like one of us.
This cool is like
us.
The Dirty Dozen.
And we got an Airbnb. And we went and seen all what Detroit has to offer, which is, it's pretty sad.
I like
it's
Detroit,
pretty,
it's, though.
Right. And we got to, so why I remembered that, and this was only a couple months back, this is what we do. And we were able to go to the old Detroit Tigers where the stadium yeah. was, and they've just left it to a field. They left the diamond there in the base pads, and the foul pole is at where it was, and they just left it. And to be able to walk around the baseline that Ty Cobb walked around, not yeah. just to say for the Detroit Tigers. Ty Cobb walked around. He played his whole career over there, but not to mention every other person who's ever played baseball and played against Detroit.
Yeah,
that has been in that the history just in that field, just in that is mind blowing.
Yeah,
we hit old theaters, we hit old schools, we hit old. There's a lot of old.
There
and
is.
Then
there's
we
like
hit
that
some
abandoned aquarium.
Oh,
and, like,
we hit so many.
Buildings.
We hit Frank Lloyd Wright houses. The house there. We got a great tour of that. We also did some Eminem stuff. You know, I'm not a huge fan. I'm not a fan at all of the music, and it's no political. You know, there's no anything yeah. in that. I'm definitely a fan of the overall picture of him
right.
as far as being like an accomplished, one of the greatest guys to ever do it. It's just not my cup of tea.
Right.
But the fact that the dude is, you know, single-handedly like synonymous with hip hop
yeah.
from a white kid from, you know,
Detroit.
Yeah. And, you know, so I tip my cap to him. It's just, but I say that with all due respect because we went there and we did all the eight mile stuff. Yeah, my boys were like, yo, Mom Spaghetti, you run. they were hyped. And I was hyped to see them that hyped.
Yeah.
So, you know, and we went to his old house from the Marshall Mathers record that he did in Scone. Someone burned it down, but we went to the lot where it was
yeah.
and we matched it up. And, to also his guy Proof that got murdered, we
yep.
went to that spot and, you know, paid our respects, really, man. I mean, this is pop culture and nothing gets left out of it, and
yeah.
it's like it's relevant stuff, and you know, God bless.
As the world gets smaller and stuff gets more, you know, the same chain stores and the same stuff all the time, I feel like there's less of these kind of places.
We're losing them on the daily. We're losing
yeah.
them on the regular. And I try to do my best to preserve it so that you can see it on Facebook. But the true story is that bigger than that, I'm trying to see it. You
yeah.
know, later for you guys. I mean, I want to show you everything, but
it's a
I'm
byproduct.
Really no. It is because I'm yeah. not. I'd be sitting here lying to tell you that's why I do it. I do it for me because I realize that, you know, having money, not having money, those things they change all the time for most people.
Yeah.
Some people never get a fluctuation in that. From my life story as an artist has been feast or famine, but one thing I am is time rich, and I'm going to take my wealth in time and spend it like you should be spent in my book, and by not only honoring the greats but being a part of to see that kind of stuff and to experience it. And
yeah.
it don't cost me nothing but a little bit of time and a little bit of gas money. And the thing is, anybody can do it, man. I encourage you, if you're into this kind of stuff, you know, check us out, the Delta Bravo Urban Exploration Team. We're just on Facebook, man, and we post all of our stuff on there, you know. And I'm not promoting anything or trying to sell
no,
you anything.
Great.
I'm just trying to tell you that, like, hopefully you see something. You know, nothing warms my heart better than when I get an email saying, like, dude, I lived in that neighborhood 25 5 years. I passed that building every day. I had no idea that that was from Superman, faster than a speeding bullet. And I when he jumps it over, it's right down the street here on La Brea. I'll show you where it is.
Oh, cool.
Where she walks out was the Carnation Milk building at the time. Now it's just the doors have changed, but it's in the same. And when you're a kid and you see Superman, you know, the black and white version, you're like, wait, they shot the opening of that right on La Brea?
That's a real place that could go to? It's crazy.
Unreal. Again, it's like, and for years I didn't even think of this stuff. So now that I've thought of it for myself, you know, let's say 2006, it's been a full-time pursuit of mine, a hobby. So every time I get to travel, whether it be here or overseas, we were talking earlier, for instance, and when I go to London, I have a few friends that take me around there, and I've got to see Quadrophenia joints. I got to see Clockwork Orange once, a lot of musical history, Sex Pistol stuff. Germany, Munich, was one of my favorite ones ever. I went to the Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. The Chocolate Factory was actually the gasworks there, and it's still there like it was in the, this thing looks like it was built in the 1700s. It's that old, and just brings you back, man.
Oh, yeah.
And it didn't cost me a cent. I was already out there doing, like, you know, House of Pain show or whatever it was. But that's what I do on my free time. And I mean, it's something that goes in your treasure chest inside your heart. You know, it's like the IRS can't tell me that I owe it. I can't smoke it.
It's,
you know, I can't fuck it
off.
I can't sell it or squander it. It's not like the tangibles that we have.
Yeah.
When I come home, it makes me a sage. It makes me one of these guys who has this extra wisdom from the experience of doing what I do. And I can sit down and tell people about these things and these stories, inspire people to go out and to try to do whatever they can to see similar things what I see.
I mean, it's not to make it too philosophical, but it's almost like a person who can see ghosts. You know, it's like now you see
a few of those too. I got a Ghostbuster machine, man. I got a ghost on. Hey, me and Lenora Claire, we went to the Star 80 murder house.
Oh, wow.
We got
Dorothy Stratton.
Stratton, she was murdered by her ex-boyfriend. Google that story.
Yeah.
We went to the
Star
house.
80 was
Star
the
80 was the movie, and they actually filmed the movie in the actual house that she got murdered in.
Man.
So we got chased
and
away.
And not that far away from when it happened, too.
No, a couple years later.
Yeah.
We went there, and I was actually periscoping it. And if you don't know what periscope is, basically live video stream on the phone. And the lady came out, and then the kid came out with the big old dog. He was getting Billy Badass on it. I told him to screw. And then we went over to the cemetery where she's buried, and also Marilyn Monroe and a plethora of other, like, huge stars, Farrah Fawcett, etc.
Is that the Hollywood Forever?
It's not the Hollywood Forever. It's the Westwood Cemetery.
Okay.
And we went over there, and we brought the ghost buster machine. It's not a buster machine. It just tells you if there's any paranormal
EPK,
stuff.
It
registers the gastometer or whatever. I don't know. It's way above my pay grade. But it was all good. It was all fun. And we went down there with Leonora Claire, and we went on the anniversary of it just to, you know.
Yeah.
Listen, these things happen, and, you know, you could get scared by them, or you can go and just...
Yeah, there's a connection to this stuff where you're seeing the history of a place, because the place, even though the aesthetics of it might change, the place is there.
Yeah,
it's always there, and everything that happened there is at the place.
Yeah, well, that house looks the same, I'll tell you that. And, you know, you go there once, you never want to go again. There's nothing good or bad about it. It's just whatever.
Yeah.
I get open more on things like, you know, finding the house from What's Happening.
Yeah.
Like when Raj first comes out, we found that. It's not that far from the Hollywood Forever Cemetery. Yeah. It's right at the straight thing. Those little, when you could break down the opening of a TV show, Chico and the Man, I found
Walk
the road in Boyle.
Down that street.
Yeah, I'd be like, yo, it's a fan. It's because while these shows were playing, I was only, you know, 10 miles west.
And had no idea.
And had no idea you could even, it's a real thing. I just you didn't even think about it in those terms. So when I, as a grown man, can go, wait a minute, the opening of, you know, What's Happening all happened on this one street.
Yeah.
Right above Santa Monica Boulevard, and I can show you which house they were and break the scene. It's still kind of...
It's great. It's, you never get over it, which is great.
I never get over it.
And the best is when you stumble on the things. Like, my wife and I like downtown a ton, and I'm a huge John Carpenter fan, and we walk around, I'm like, They Live camp, and this is the church from Prince of Darkness. Like, we're standing outside the church from Prince of Darkness.
A lot of They Live is gone because those homeless lots, those were real kind of things. I don't even think the church is there. I went looking for that. I couldn't find it.
It was there last year. It's on
the church?
Yeah, the church from Prince of Darkness. Oh, no, not
no,
from They Live.
From
the
they
church
live.
From They Live is
I
gone.
I think it's
the
gone
Prince
because they built all that stuff on that hill over there. But the alley where the fight is, I've done it.
Yep.
Redid it. I the athletic club is still there. The paper stand's gone. But I mean, those downtown shots are still there. That's a classic, by the way.
I love that.
I love what Rodney Piper said on his last tweet. You know what he said, right?
Oh, and his last two before he died?
Yeah. Well, it had been running for a while, but it said They Live is a documentary.
Yeah. That movie is scary. That's the truth. Really scary watching now when you see that. We rewatched it the other night. And
yeah, I won't say I'm on I use that as an icon on a board I'm on. You know.
Yeah. You don't want to give it away.
No. It's pretty simple. It's none of my name. My Delta Bravo.
Yeah.
But the guys on that board haven't figured it out. It's actually an Art Bell board.
Okay.
Now I'm giving my cover, but it's on an Art Bell.
Do
you know who Art Bell is? The radio host?
Yeah, yeah.
The paranormal guy?
Yeah.
Well, he quit again and broke everybody's heart. So I'm like, they think I'm a troll on there, but I'm just calling him out on his bullshit.
He's kept me company many a when I've done stand-up gigs and long night drives. I love, I remember listening to this guy talk about how Bigfoots were actually aliens who are ghosts, and he had this whole theory.
Stink apes.
Yeah. And I was like, you know what? This kind of made, like, after like an hour driving, it kind of made sense. But yeah, all that stuff is there, and we go down there every time we come here. And
it's nice. It's like a pilgrimage.
That's yeah.
I do the same in Tulsa. You know, I revisit the same places I've been over and over, and just it's something to do. It's a pastime. It's for free. It's for fun. I get to share it now. We live in an age where in the past it would have been hard to really share that.
It's hard to find like-minded people for a long time, and now you can.
And so I post it, and you know, it's nice when my friends go, wow, Dan, it's so dope that you get to go there.
Yeah.
Someday I hope I get to go there. And I say, hey, when you do, call this guy.
Right.
Make sure you see that and stay here.
Because I imagine in like the House of Pain touring days in 94, if you were like, guys, can we go stop at this place?
They'd
be like, I don't think we want to.
Even when we first did when I first figured out The Outsiders was filmed there, nobody was interested in going.
Yeah.
And that's okay. I get it. Because until you're interested in it, you're like, what are they talking about?
Yeah.
Even right now, sometimes when I hear myself talk, I go, if you don't understand this kind of thing, you're like, what are they going on about? Like,
right.
Who gives
a
flying?
It's just a building. Yeah.
Yeah. And people who get it, they get it. And
yeah.
So it's for them.
Yeah.
It's for us. You know what I mean? And for me, it's a breath of fresh air, especially coming out of like that bling bling hip hop era. After my era, but that was the era, and everybody in this fucking place is TMZ'd out for the last decade, and now the Kardashians, and they're starting to be. But in a world of all that stuff, I'm going back to the purest stuff, which was the directors, the writers, the authors, the actors of that generation. And for me, it ends in the mid-80s. Anything after that, people we talked today, I was with my boy, who's a Boston guy, George Carroll, he's a rapper named Slane is the name he goes by. He's also an actor, was in Gone Baby Gone.
Oh, yeah.
He was in The Town.
Yeah. Right. He's the drug dealer in Gone Baby
Gone.
Yeah.
So I just dropped him off. That's it. So, we're in a band together, La Coca Nostra, but you know, he'll always be like, yo kid, did you see the and I'm like, bro, I don't really see, you know, the Whitey Bulger film, it was okay, but and I'm like, dude, even though that's like the topic is interesting, I don't,
you
until
don't have
it
connection
run,
to it.
I don't, and I don't see modern stuff. I opt out of all the stuff. So the things that people go on about, I'm just like, who cares? And so I know that this is a niche, really small market of people who like it, but people who do, you can't talk enough about it.
Yeah, I mean, I think that a couple of things is that you hit you the right age at the right time before MTV, before the internet, and you felt like you were the only person that liked that thing, so it really meant something to you. And in the late 80s into the 90s, we started getting ironic. We started getting less sincere about things as a culture and stuff like the Kardashians. I don't think anyone has a connection to them like you have to Fast and Furious High. It's all aspirational stuff now, or they want to see rich people fail.
Yeah.
So
no, of course,
so
they want to see the train wreck.
Yeah.
I mean, that's kind of what's.
Yeah.
What's,
it's a circus.
You know, I've been at 10 different meetings with really high powered reality TV show people who all love Delta Bravo, but once they realize that it's not like we're not going to be fighting on it, we're not going to be taking anything, then selling it, doubling our money from these things, we're not going to bastardize the locations.
Yeah.
They're like, okay, I don't know if there's a show here, guys.
Yeah.
I'm like, you
where's
know what?
The drama?
Yeah, we don't do that, you know? So it's like, it's been a tough sell as far as that. But I do believe that people like us, if we did watch TV, it would be that, you know what I mean?
Oh, I'd totally watch that. And you know, when you're talking about the Fast Times school, I was thinking about all the kids that go there now, and they don't know.
And
do
they
care?
Because it's not there. So, for instance, like, you know, I have a sister that's a couple of years different. I don't think she cares about Fast Times, and I'm guessing. I'm sure Clueless is more her lane, because 2 years is all the difference in the world.
Oh,
that's
a
high school kid to a junior high school
kid.
And mind-wise, on two different, like,
you know, and Clueless might have been more up her Strauss at the time, you know, something that was like more she could relate to, where Fast Times was mine, you know. So I don't think the kids really care. I can guarantee you probably you could, you it would be nice to you could sit out in front of there and make almost like a parody video of like, have you ever heard of Fast Times? Yeah. Fast Times? You know, it's
that's the show. They wouldn't know. Kids know about the place they're at every day, you know?
Listen, I offered, it was a token offer. Not, it wasn't a token offer, but it was, the school didn't know, but I said I would love to go back to Claremont High and talk to the kids for about an hour about what I do with Delta Bravo and how it kind of all started with The Outsiders and Fast Times, which brings me to your school in San Diego. And did you know what the impact that that movie had? And you were at ground zero of that. The school, when I walked the school, so we drove, me and my wife, on a Sunday to San Diego, to Claremont High School, and there was an open fence, and we walked the school, and I've read the book a few times, and whether you've read the book or just watched the movie, you feel like you're at Fast Times at Ridgemont High, because it's described, and it just has that vibe. The courtyard, the food scene, the whole, and I've obviously it was filmed at Van Nuys. I've walked that, but almost Claremont feels more like where, you know, and they're pretty similar, but there's just some kind of mystical, like, weird thing different. And I'm thinking, which one was the real Mike Damone's locker? Where was Spicoli's at this time? And was he in this class? Was this the class they were talking about?
It's a weird, uncanny thing to be at a place you've never been to before but know where everything is. And that's what it was like when I went to the Monroeville Mall. I've seen Dawn of the Dead probably 75 times, and I was like, right down this hallway, I know what's going to be there. And you turn around and you know, and you're dead. You know? And I was going in this elevator, and people were looking at me like, I'm in JCPenney going down the escalator with a smile on my face. And they probably think I was in prison for 30 years. And never
and what'd that cost you to do that?
Nothing.
Exactly. Yeah.
I went into, they had a Hot Topic in there. And, you know, there's like some disaffected teenage girls working in there. And they were selling, you know, horror movie shirts. And in the clearance section, they had a Dawn of the Dead shirt. And I'm like, I gotta buy it.
Of course.
You know? So I said to her, I'm like, oh, this is so weird. You know, I'm buying this shirt here. And she goes, why?
Yeah, of course.
And I go, they shot this movie here. And she goes, what? She had no idea. Yeah, you know, no, and I'm like, they don't even know. And it's fine that they don't. I don't expect them to. Yeah. But it almost made me feel better about it.
There's a bar where they shot the Rumblefish in Tulsa. It's called Valkyrie Bar, and it's nice. It's like a beautiful hipster bar that they've turned it into, but it was Benny's Billiards in the movie, which is the main location. And how do you have that and not keep like a ghost painting of like Benny's Billiards on your window, just like tonal, that something. People are like, what is that? Yeah. You didn't know? This is the
shot a
they
movie
could
here.
Care less. Yeah, people it's just like it's disposable stuff. So for me, it isn't. And for me, I did my best to, you know, honor it by visiting it and exploring it and showing it to other people. Through it, I've been able to meet a lot of the writers, directors, actors. S.E. Hinton was one of my favorites. I went to Tulsa and sat down and had lunch with S.E. and picked her brain and gave her some of my, you know,
it's
anecdotal,
weird,
you know, and just told her what an impact it made. And I'm sure she's heard it a million times from a million people, but she took the time out to do that with me. And now when I tweet stuff, she retweets it, which is awkward because I'm like, oh, no.
We get to say thank you to her.
Yeah,
too,
no, I do. But it's like, oh, it's a La Coca Nostra. Like, I hope she doesn't like not know what that is. Yeah, she's like pushing like this hardcore rap where we're talking about. Like, I just like, no. Like, just ignore those
ignore
ones.
This one.
Is like, this is the next level of like debauchery that you know nothing about that we do. But just redo the, you know.
I
found a switchblade that looks, it's the same, you know, model and brand that they used in the Outsiders. I'm like that. So I try to buy things that are pieces of the movie, even if it's just like it or similar types to it. I collect all the lobby cards, the original posters, ads. I'm trying to think what else I've got, stuff like that. And, you know, most of it is we try to collect the experiences, not the outside stuff. But I do have a nice little healthy collection. Bad News Bears is another favorite of mine, and I know most of the actors in it.
Yep.
I've got baseball signed by them all. I've got
another
bats.
Thing that had a TV series that wasn't quite as good.
And my friend was in it, Mino Palouse.
Oh, yeah.
And, but I know all the original actors now from the Bad News Bears, and shout out to all the Bears. I just, my Saturday, I do my thing. And Brandon Cruz, he was the Yankees pitcher.
He was in Dr. No. Was that the band he was in?
Yeah. Wow, you're good, man. You should do this for a living.
He sang with the Dead Kennedys for a while.
Wow. Yeah. Man, you really know your stuff.
I was in a punk band in Boston in the 90s.
Okay.
And they came through.
What was the band?
We were called 30 Seconds Over Tokyo. We started with like Dropkick Murphys.
Dope,
and bands like that. But yeah, and I was so psyched that Brent, I'm like, it's Brendan Cruz.
Yeah, from Courtship of Eddie's Father.
They're like, what are you talking about?
Yeah, well, even I'm 47. I never seen the show, but I know the song that people let me tell you about my best friend. He's a great guy. And, you know, I'm here. My guilty pleasure is to pick his brain of more Bad News stuff, you know, like I'm like, oh, that's great, you did all that other stuff. Hey, so tell me about Bad News.
Yes,
because I love that movie. So there's those movies that I have, like, so Fast Times, The Outsiders, Bad News Bears, Valley Girl.
I love Valley Girl.
Julie Richmond, who is Deborah Foreman.
Yep,
we're good friends now. She's when we go up to Big Bear, she opens her house to us. We get to stay in her room and go to breakfast with her. She's fantastic, great. You know, I'm honored. I can't believe it. I'm like, oh my god. I know these people, they're so cool. And it's like, that's my lane.
Yeah.
So to be able to, you know, rub elbows with you know, these people.
I mean, that's
people,
why I do this show. It's the same exact thing.
Yeah, I know. So it's like, it allows me to be a childlike again in the most mature way possible.
Yeah.
So I'm looking at it with like the eyes I had, which are curious and wide open as a young adult. Coming of age, these are the movies that had the most impact on me and the coolest movies.
Yeah.
And so I can never, you know, I do as much as I can. And on the same token, not for nothing, and I'm not trying to toot my own horn, but I have a little celebrity too, you know, and I don't raise my hand on anything. Like, if I don't like your thing, I ain't reposting. I'm very,
right.
my pages and my stuff is like my vision board. It's well groomed and it's well, I don't want you putting spam on it or putting like.
Well, you got a brand and you want to keep
it. Yeah. And so when if you follow any of the stuff I do, I don't have to tell you what I like, because you will see Valley Girl, you will see Fast Times, you will see The Bad News, and if you don't like that, we won't get along, because right. those are my things. And you know, shout out to all those people, man. It's like sometimes I pinch myself, you know, like, what, like lunch with SC, like staying at Deborah Foreman's, like hanging out with Mike Damone, which like, yo, it's like Robert Romanus, like, we go eat Swingers, the diner over here, you know, every 2 weeks. And I'm blessed, man.
Yeah,
and my gratitude is very high. I mean, I no matter what comes, good, bad, or indifferent, rich, poor, all that other stuff, at the end of the day, it's, you know, it's the friends and the bonds you make and the experiences. That's what, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, to sort of tie it all together to wrap up, it's one, you know, my life philosophy is people should just be better off for having known you. And if that's the smallest thing, if it's only known you through your work, or personally, or whatever it is. And that ties into the fact that when you make art, even if it's something you looked at as just a job and it's out there, you can't ever dismiss it, because the most mundane or dumb sitcom or stupid thing you could imagine, there's a kid out there that it means the world to, or it was the moment. You know, I had the guys from The Damned did the show.
Nice.
And when I saw them on The Young Ones, that literally changed my life.
Yeah.
I was 6 years old and I went, this is the thing that I like. I didn't know until
then. And where'd you see The Young Ones? In Boston?
MTV. Oh, they aired on MTV.
I didn't know about it till later.
Yeah.
But you know what's funny? I'll give you this, is that, you know, me and Jonesy are good friends, and I asked him, you know, I'm always, again, like, you know, we'll be doing regular things, then I'll slip one in there.
Tell
like,
a little
hey,
bit about-
yeah. Hey, Jonesy, real quick, what was your favorite punk band? He's hanging up for his answer.
Yeah.
And he's like, The Damned.
Yeah.
I was like, wow, okay.
Incredible.
No, I know, but I just, you never know where that's going to, you know what I mean?
To have and to then, hear it from him is different.
Right. And then from there, it goes to like The Faces, Mott the Hoople, and there's no punk in there. And you're just like, The Damned.
It's the stuff he grew up with.
But it's very important to me. I need to know the order of things in the people that I look as heroes.
Yep.
And, it you know, again.
What made you make
the
thing that
I
love?
Yeah. So I'm very interested in that kind of thing. And I was, you know, wasn't shocked, but I was just like, okay, cool.
Yeah.
I
didn't expect that, but it makes
sense. Yeah. I don't know who I expected. Yeah. I really don't, because I look at them as like early pioneers of it. So it's kind of like, you know, everything else came after that besides, you know, you can have the argument of, you know, Detroit and New York. And
but that's all
that. But what I'm saying is that it was nice to see that he went lateral and said, The Damned, that was a real answer.
Yeah,
it was a real answer. Yeah.
And it's amazing to, so you put this stuff out there and it changes people's lives, like you and I, and when we saw these things. And then for us, we've gotten to do that extra step where we get to thank those people.
Yeah, and that's what I was trying to say about mine. Like, you know, so I have a whole different audience, and I open these audience people up, or I salute it when it, when we run it up the flagpole. The people are like, okay, if it's that cool for Danny, then maybe it's cool for me.
Yeah.
I always did like that movie. I just didn't want to tell anybody Valley Girl was my right. thing.
Yeah, I mean, because it seemed a little House soft. Pain and Valley Girl,
yeah, you know? No, but, you know, people who know me, then they would. So it's like, yeah. cool. And then Deborah Foreman's page, you know, some of it probably unwanted, but it gets a lot of attention. And then this guy's one does, and then Damone's does, and then this one. And so we all circulate, and, you know, it's a good, you
it's
know,
a great
mutual
unifier.
Appreciation yeah. society yeah. of all things. And it's the most, I'm going to say, the most eclectic bunch you could assemble.
But it's more it's, pure,
yeah,
sort of.
Yeah, because it's all real. And it's like, yeah, we're all fans of keep each other's stuff in general. And just it's to make it this far and still be doing our thing and still be, you know.
And you're still into it. That's the thing. I keep waiting to get over this stuff.
Again, I know I flubbed the whole TV Guide thing. It looked like a homework to me. And then I got scared to even like. But I looked in there and I seen Alice. And I said it before, but, you know, that show when I was a kid, it was always on. And I always liked that show.
Yeah.
And originally cast in the Tommy role was Alfred Luder from the Bad News Bears.
I think he
did the pilot and then decided it wasn't for him. But Alice... she worked at Mel's, in case you don't know, Mel's Diner, where she used to tell Mel to kiss her grits. That was Flo, actually. Yeah. But Mel's Diner still exists, and it's in Arizona, and the sign is just like it was in the opening of season two.
Wow.
And it says Mel's with the arrow, and I went there, of course, and then I went there with my wife, and we had breakfast there as well on our way to Tulsa. So these things are out there, and it's a trip, dude, because, again, it's like... What the thing from like the late 70s and it's
still
like it's, and they shot the opening there. It's weird because usually it's on a set in Burbank. This was a real thing, and that was a real Alice doesn't live here anymore.
Yeah, I think it
was,
Martin Scorsese movie that spun off a drama made it to a comedy series
which was a real story about it, like a lady, and she ended up Phoenix was as far she was trying to come west, I think, and finally she
ran out of money.
The car blew up or whatever, and she just said this is it. And you know, you gotta love stuff like that. And if you don't, you know,
they're these real, they're like new folk stories, you know, they're like real American history of that stuff. So I always ask this of musicians on the show, your favorite TV theme song.
Favorite TV theme song? There's a bunch. And I was going to say on the quick answer, it was going to be Taxi for sure.
Yeah.
Which is Angela's theme.
Very minor, low key. Like you said, MASH earlier too. Like you like the sad.
I can cry sometimes if Taxi comes on.
It is sad.
And it is Bob James, which a lot of people may or may not know, but it was also Bob James who is a hip-hop staple for being sampled. So anytime you hear like Rock the Bells from LL Cool J, that's the song called Live from the Mardi Gras. Ding, 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 ding. And he also has Nautilus, which was sampled by like Eric B. and Rakim. You hear it once, you'll never mistake it again. It's been sampled a million times, but he also wrote Angela's theme to Taxi, which was supposed to be on some football album, which is another. But when I hear it, it just brings a warm, it's a toss-up. I know, I'll say this, Mary Tyler Moore, and because I grew up watching, my mother was like her hero on television. It was the first like single lady doing her, you know,
doing her thing.
And so
she's
I have
make
this,
it after all.
Yeah, and I went to, I was lucky enough to go to her, where they filmed that in Minneapolis. Her house, the apartment building, which is now called the Crack Shack. It was like this futuristic modern thing, and now it's like Somalians overrun it. Cops don't go near it.
It looks like Cabrini Green and Candyman.
Yo,
now.
That's my man. I just interviewed. I was going to say
Tony Kirster.
No,
Bernard Rose.
Yeah, damn, you're like he might have met his match. talking to you, I mean, like, what don't you know? Yeah, I'm friends with Bernard, and I didn't know his. I don't watch those kind of movies, and so. We were talking about Cabrini Green, which I do know about, which was like a real notorious. They've since torn it down.
Good time.
But it was like, was it Cabrini?
It was
Cabrini. So Cabrini Green is no joke. It's gone now. What I really like, what was the one that bonded us real was he did the Frankie Goes to Hollywood video, the X-rated one, where he went to the gay nightclub and did it. And now clearly I'm not gay. I'm a married man. That being said, it also hip hop is a very homophobic genre of music to be involved in, and I am not that. And not only that, I think it's the most revolutionary punk thing to do in the 80s to get kicked off BBC and have zero chance of getting any play on MTV and have a hit song that Frankie Goes to Hollywood. By being banned, it drove that song to number one.
Absolutely.
And that was my man.
There's that whole scene in the tower video.
Yeah. And he did all the UB40 stuff. But I thought, you know what? These are the kind of guys that I admire that take a risk and go against the grain. I mean, we're looking back at a time where Elton John was married to a lady saying, I'm not gay. And, and Wham was supposed to be, mate, I'm not, you know.
It's young
it's
guns
like,
go for it. He loves chicks, man.
Exactly. Yeah. And it's like, young cats might forget, but I remember a time where like, yo, that shit did not pass.
You could not get under, and
you could not come out and say, yo, this, that, and the third. So
for Frankie Goes to Hollywood to be like, fuck it, this is what we do.
Bernard Rose said it the best, but he says, man, I'm not going to fucking fuck about and pretend that we're something we're not. We're gay, we're proud of it.
Yeah.
And Bernard said, good, and then we're going to go back to that club where you guys do your thing,
yep,
in the gayest club in London, and we're going to just film there. And they were like, really? And they were like, really? And so hats off to that. That's the real punk attitude to me. And outwitted, outmatched. I just ask a question and stand back, and Bernard just gets it going. And
he made an amazing movie called Paper House that is, I think it might have been his first movie.
Okay.
And it's like haunting and beautiful and smart and weird.
I got to look all his stuff, man, because, you know, as a person, you know, at first I was like, I don't think me and him will get along, you know, it doesn't seem like, you know, kind of dude. And then we go to lunch every week, and it was just like listening to him talk. I was like, this guy, something special about this guy.
Yeah.
And then we hit it off. We found that mutual ground, and then we just started going in, and his humor is sick, and we have the same kind of weird little quirky thing going on. And he's just, there's not many dudes like that, you know? So it shines, even though I'm not familiar with all the work, you know. I Googled him as soon as I was like, wait a minute, there's something right here. Yeah. Who is this guy?
But you get a similar
passion. Yeah, he's got a guy who wins like some BBC film award at 14. I'm like, figures.
Yeah.
That comes off in the lunches, even though he's not trying to be like that.
Yeah.
I knew it was something different. One of these things is unlike the other, and he's something special. So, yeah, it's like that. You know, this thing is, again, you know, I ended up going to see a few Outsiders locations and a few things in New York, Son of Sam locations where the actual, like, you know, crimes were going down. And it's turned into this warm, lovely family of like-minded urban explorers, men, women, some old, some young, some law enforcement. What? Like hanging with cops? How did that happen? And it's like some of my best friends are cops. Some of my, it's just such a hodgepodge of different backgrounds and styles, and we love it, and we got the tightest squad, and nobody does it like we do it. Delta Bravo does it better, and we do it because we bring a brand mentality to it, and we bring a kind of like a, we're like grown-up Goonies, you know what I mean? It's like we're going on pirate adventures. For me, my hero is Pippi Longstockings, you know? As a kid, she tied a balloon to her bed, and her and Tommy and Annika fucked off and went and traveled the world. And I'm like, yo, that seems like right to me, you know, like
we don't need that.
I just want to tie a balloon to the bed and let's get up out of here and let's go see the world. And we kind of do it like that. None of us are rich. None of us are like well off. Like there's a lot of dudes are like unemployed or whatever, but we load that cop car up and we just pitch in for gas and we get cheap Airbnbs. And
you don't have to go far.
You don't need much, man. Yeah. A little Cafe Bustelo goes a long way. You know what I'm saying?
I mean, to end here, it's, you know, we were talking about the very beginning. It's people from all different backgrounds, but if you go back far enough, you all have this shared experience of popular culture, and popular culture gets written off, but that's what it does. And it may be disposable and in certain cases, but it changes people's lives in a certain way, and it puts you on a path, and it gives you this connection to people that you may not have met.
I glossed over for 30 years. Didn't even realize we had that shared experience. So when it started, I think it came with age. You know, if you made it to this far, you know what I mean? There were people who were 10 times faster than me, 100 times more talented than me, and everything in between. And a lot of people, when I was young, people say, man, you'd be surprised, you get older, man, half your friends will be in, half my friends are in jail or dead. And I thought, all right, old man, slow down. You know, you're talking a little crazy right now. Right now, a lot of people are gone, dude.
Yeah.
And I'm not trying to sound like, oh, like whatever. And so the ones that are still here, we cherish those simpler times.
Yeah.
And we celebrate those by going that. And we're also looking forward to new ones. So it's a good way to be. And again, man, I encourage anybody who wants to get down. We're not like a fraternal organization. You don't get to join us. You kind of just...
no hazing.
No, there's no... But on the same token, you kind of got to get in where you fit in. And enough people decide, oh, all right, who's this guy? But he seems cool and he posts good. Then, yeah, you made it. And the thing is, you don't need us to do it. I give it out for free. A lot of these people who are doing movie locations, what separated us from them is that they were hiding the addresses. We're just showing the before and afters. Yeah. Weren't telling you where they were. I give it all up. So you don't need me to do anything. You can get a bus pass, and all you need to do is get on there and go see it for yourself. If you have a car, even better. You have a cell phone, even better. You really don't need that much to do it, and it could change your life if you're, you know, if you're into this stuff.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for doing the show. It's been great talking to you, man.
Yeah, my pleasure. I look forward to doing the next time you're in LA, man. I'll bring Slane and I'll bring
tours.
A couple of we can do that as well.
Yeah.
Look forward.
There you go. Danny O'Connor, as I said, fascinating guy, really fun guy to talk to. You were probably surprised. Who would have thought that Danny Boy from House of Pain, really into Fast Times at Ridgemont High and Valley Girl, as I am. Really good guy. I will put links up to Delta Bravo and to the music stuff he's doing now, all on TVGuidanceCounselor.com. You can email me at ken@icanread.com or at TVGuidanceCounselor@gmail.com. As always, I am also on Twitter at TV Guidance or on Facebook. Just search TV Guidance Counselor. I love hearing from you guys. If you listen to the show on iTunes, be sure to rate and review the show. It is a huge help for getting the word out about the show. Again, I may see you at the House of Pain show if you're in Boston next week for that show. Should be a lot of fun. And at the very least, I'll see you again next Wednesday for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
There's times where I go, why did I ever like this thing? You could never get a 22-year-old man to convince a principal to let you attend undercover high school for 1 year. Can I curse? It's too late.
Yeah. Oh, yes. Please do. Okay.
No pools and no schools. So I did what any respectful Irishman would do. I had a friend who had a drone and we flew it right over her house. We violated her spot and we put it right in her backyard. All right, drive a cop car, guys.